I think the president is going to try to very much follow along the lines of the principles that he's followed over the course of his first term. He wants to engage the region as a whole. He sees China central to the region, so that building ties to China is an integral part of a region-wide strategy. He hopes to be able to focus more on this region and less on the Middle East than was the case during his first term. But he really sees America's future interests as more involved with Asia than with any other region of the world. So he wants to have a diplomatic, economic, and security strategy for this region that ensures long-term, wide-ranging, effective American participation. Well, we have an enormously wide-ranging, deep, and I think reasonably effective set of ties with China. Virtually every U.S. cabinet agency deals with its Chinese counterpart virtually every week. Our leaders know each other well, our key cabinet officers know each other well, and so forth. So this is largely a matter, I think, of engaging with the Chinese to discuss why we're doing what we're doing, how they see it, why they see it that way, and see whether we can reduce distrust and maximize our capacity to cooperate. You know, fundamentally, China wants a stable, peaceful, prosperous Asia, and so do we. It isn't that all of our interests are exactly the same here. There are obviously tensions and competition in aspects of our relationship. But it isn't as if either one of us thinks that we can kick the other out of the region. Both recognize that every single country in the region wants to avoid having to choose whether to side with China or side with the U.S. Every single country in the region wants both of us actively engaged there. And either one that tries to fundamentally upset that apple cart is going to suffer because of that. So within that broad framework, it's a matter of intensive diplomacy to try to make sure that we can maximize the upside and minimize the problems that both of us confront. I think we have three major challenges. One is actually, in a sense, third-party issues. These are the territorial disputes that China has with Japan and with a number of countries in Southeast Asia. Frankly, the U.S. would rather not be involved in these, but for a variety of reasons. For example, we have an alliance with Japan. That alliance covers the Diaoyu Islands. So, you know, those disputes and how they're resolved will affect very possibly the issues in our bilateral relationship with China. Secondly, we have, despite a wide-ranging and mature relationship with China, we really have a dearth of trust in each other's long-term intentions. I think we feel pretty good about our ability to understand short-term issues, but not the long-term. So I think we need a new kind of dialogue and new types of activities with China to try to build more confidence in the notion on each side that over the long run, we want to have a normal big power relationship and not become each other's biggest single problem. So I think that requires some dialogue on long-term strategic postures. It certainly requires much more engagement of our two militaries and beyond the kind of formal level talks that we now have, but have people in each other's military academies and so forth. Now, the third big issue is an underlying issue, which is to say both China and the United States need to undertake substantial economic and related political changes domestically if we're going to prevent a situation a decade from now where we are in deep, deep trouble. For all the details differ. That fundamental reality is the same for both countries. Both need serious reforms. On the U.S. side, it needs to be on primarily fiscal issues. On China, it's a much more wide-ranging set of issues. The fundamental reality is the changes each side needs to make. It's not only in its own interest, but also in the interest of the other side. To the extent that each of us falls short in making those changes, our bilateral relationship will be more difficult. To the extent that each of us does make those changes, it will smooth the way in a lot of ways for a more effective bilateral relationship. So, ironically, the quality of our bilateral relationship is going to depend in no small part on how each of us handles our own domestic challenges, because those domestic challenges involve an enormous array of issues of vital interest to the other side.